I'm Andrew Graham-Dixon, and I'm an art historian.
I'm Giorgio Locatelli, and I'm a chef. We are both passionate about my homeland, Italy.
The smells, the colour, this is what food is all about for me.
The rich flavours and classic dishes of this land are in my culinary DNA.
And this country's rich layers of art and history have captivated me since childhood.
It's meant to make you feel as if you are being whirled up to heaven.
We're stepping off the tourist track and exploring Italy's northern regions of Emilia-Romagna, Lombardy and Piedmont.
It's part of Italy that's often overlooked, but it drives the whole country. And I want to show off its classic dishes.
Not to mention its hidden legacy of artists, designers, intellectuals.
Wow, look at that.
This week we are in Piedmont, Italy's best kept secret.
Where people's deep connection with the land has created a very special blend of art, food, and popular culture.
A winning recipe for modern life.
Located on the Italian side of Mont Blanc, Piedmont has the most majestic landscapes in Italy. It was once the gateway to the whole country. When Hannibal invaded in the 3rd century BC, this was his way in. With its unspoilt natural beauty, it's inspired many artists, not least one of my favourites, England's greatest painter, Turner.
For me, Piedmont is a food lover's paradise. There is something delectable here to tickle everyone's palate, from sweet to savoury, and always the finest quality. And this region is home to one of the most prized delicacies. It epitomizes the wonderful earthy food here, the truffle. But sometimes in Piedmont, the best things are the hardest to find. We are searching for one of these rare funghi with my friend Sandrino in the forest near Asti.
Vediamo se troviamo. Se troviamo un buon tartufo per colazione.
We'll find, see if we can find a good truffle for breakfast.
Vigo, guarda bene, sì.
The pure air, rich soil and dense fog in this part of southern Piedmont have created the perfect condition for the best truffle to grow. Sandrino's won the prestigious Golden Truffle Award 10 times. And if anyone can find one of these prize nuggets, it's him.
Il tartufo può... Lo puoi trovare sin dove arriva l'ombra della pianta.
Yeah, it always grows where the shadow of the tree is. It's never out of the shadow, it never grows on a sunny place. Obviously because it's a fungus.
Vigo, guarda bene, dai.
Su, su.
Ok, così, bravo.
So what's the dog doing at the moment?
He's just... At the moment he's scouting.
Aspetta! Aspetta!
Abbiamo trovato qualcosa?
You can smell the ground.
Credo
there
di
you
sì.
Smell
Credo
the ground.
Sì. Credo di sì. Bravo, amigo.
You can't smell truffle in the air.
There you are. Oh. Disappointed because it's small.
Saremo più fortunati.
The next one would be more lucky.
The finest restaurants from all over the world clamor to secure the peak of each year's harvest. And with truffle going for as much as £5,000 a kilo, the business of finding these precious pearls is taken very seriously.
Sandrino, sono curioso. Come si dice muscle? Musetto?
Ah, la museruola.
Ma museruolo, perché porta la museruola il cane?
Perché c'è molta concorrenza. Molta concorrenza sleale, non onesta. E mettono molto volentieri del cibo avvelenato.
They will put down some
his competitors will put down poison meat.
Poison meat.
Ma perché? Per uccidere il cane.
Per uccidere il cane.
And that takes one more person out
Can't
of the...
Can't take less.
Possibile. Guarda bene. Vigo, è lì? Guarda bene, su. Dai, guarda bene. Lì, lì, è lì? C'è lì?
Has he found another one?
There you are. That's a truffle. That's a big one.
A te l'onore.
I'll get it out.
You don't want to break any off, I guess.
Piano? Okay, stop, stop.
Wow! Like a potato!
That's this is good for breakfast.
Yeah!
It is good.
That's really good. That is something.
It's very epic.
We're all pleased with you because we can have breakfast now.
Sandrino, come on, give us some truffle.
€5, €10, 50.
Dai, it's too thick, Sandrino. Non è che non l'abbiamo pagato, però.
Well, I'm just gonna have to bite off the edge there.
You rip off the little bit at the end.
Tear off the bit at the
and
end.
And then you use it to
use
eat.
Use that
it, like,
as a sort of dipper.
Right. That's right.
Wow. Vieni qua. Wow. Come buono.
It's just the smell of the ground, the smell of what nature smells like, isn't it? It's all in there.
I think when you've got the wood smoke, it's like you're eating the wood itself. Wow.
When they say it's a king food now, you know why.
According to Sandrino, the best way to get underneath the skin of Piedmont is to explore it by foot. And since this is historically a land of pilgrimage, we're following his advice. We're on an ancient track called the Via Francigena. 1,000 years old, it once linked Canterbury to the eternal city of Rome.
So nowadays, I suppose the pilgrimage route that leads to Santa Maria de Compostela is the most famous, but back in the Middle Ages, the Via Francigena was the most popular pilgrimage route from north to south. Well, they used to believe that each mile that you walked was another day off for your eternal soul from purgatory. So you'd get to heaven more quickly.
So we would be straight in paradise after this.
Each I was blister, already there. Each blister.
We're looking for the exit of the pathway, where it opens out to reveal the Susa Valley, just about 30 kilometres from the French border.
So, Andrew, where are we? You got the map?
Well, we should be at the bottom of the old donkey path.
Oh, la mulattiera.
Which is where there's the punto di vista panoramica. Panoramic view.
Not today.
Travelling pilgrims needed places to rest, and the valley is dotted with beautiful monasteries and abbeys. One of the oldest, a real hidden gem, is the Abbey of Novalesa. Home to some fascinating art, it's still open to pilgrims today, and still home to a community of monks. This is Father Daniele.
Che significa fare il peregrinaggio?
Molto importante, perché significa il cammino della vita. Uno che lascia tutto, rimane solo, cammina per la strada, incontra temperie, forse anche ladroni. Questo si abbandona totalmente a Dio per andare a un santuario.
It almost seems to me it's a way of purifying yourself of the temptations of life.
Per purificarti, il cammino che ti purifica.
Sì, sì.
E il fatto di arrivare che
purifica perché si trova solo per la strada.
You can only find it on the road.
Luogo sconosciuto.
The place that you don't know. That's where you can find yourself.
Sì. Well, noi continuiamo il nostro viaggio. Grazie tanto.
Arrivederci.
Arrivederci.
Grazie.
I've known for years that there are some wonderful 11th century frescoes in the chapels here, but I've never managed a visit before. It's not the easiest place to reach.
Look, I love it. It's almost a list of Silvestro Luigi came here on the 21st of June, 1857. Got there. Somebody called Forlagiuzzi came in 1960, 1923. I think for a lot of people, writing your name on the wall might almost be a way of saying, well, I hope my prayers come true.
Okay, it's like a...
It's almost like a way... This is not just graffiti, it's almost like praying in the form of graffiti. Look at this.
How old are this?
Really, really... really old. This is very unusual to find paintings as old as this in such good condition up in the mountains with the damp air.
These paintings have a raw, almost primitive energy. The effect they had on traveling pilgrims can only be imagined.
These frescoes were painted 960 years ago.
1070, 4 years after William the Conqueror's invading England, 1066 and all that. You come in and instantly you're under the eye of Christ. Christ Pantocrator, it's this moment when Italian art and Byzantine art are really one and the same thing. You know, all the way from Beirut to Dunfermline, Christianity is one thing. Here we've got St. Eldred, or St. Eldred.
Which the story is that he was a very rich person, and then he gives everything away. And that's where he becomes a pilgrim, because you see, he's given the stick.
Exactly.
With a stick and the bag.
So you know the story?
No, but it's pretty... it does really explain himself, doesn't it?
Well, what's nice about this here, also makes it unusual, is that St. Eldred actually was the head of this monastery, and he happens to be the patron saint of pilgrimage. So we have, as it were, pilgrimage to the origin of pilgrimage.
And that's where he becomes a monk.
I love it. It's sort of such, it's such cartoon language. He drops all his possessions, and they place the monk's habit on him. Oh, yeah. Don't you think the colours are wonderful?
Wonderful.
Dyes made from the fruit and the vegetables from round here. There's probably dye made from, I don't know, blackberry juice or blueberry juice. There'd be dyes made from other vegetable compounds. It's really simple, made from the earth. You'd come out of the cold. The brothers would give you something simple to eat. And then you come here, and here you get sustenance for your soul.
Yes, sustenance for your body and for your soul, ready to carry on the
ready track. To carry on to Rome.
Our modern pilgrimage through Piedmont now leads us to a very special location. It seems to me that everything is connected to purity, spirituality, and responsibility here. And as so often in Italy, that includes the food. The Piemontese defend the purity of the food chain more than any other people that I can think of. So it makes sense that this place gave birth to the ethical food movement that's taken the world by storm. Called Slow Food, it was founded by a good friend of mine.
You're gonna meet this guy, he's called Carlo Petrini, but everybody calls him Il Carlin. He's the leader maximum of the movement, he's the founder of it. He's a mercurial character, this guy. He's just like a volcano of idea.
And it happened here in we're just coming into the foothills.
Yes.
Going to be there soon.
And not something that you think was gonna rock the world when you see it.
Okay.
Slow Food was founded in 1986 in opposition to the growth of the fast food industry. It's now a global movement with over 100,000 members and is still rooted in the Piemontese idea of preserving and protecting the tradition of regional food. We are meeting Carlo at the University of Gastronomic Science outside Bra, an institute he founded to spread his ideas.
Allora?
Allora,
tre aggettivi. Buono, pulito e giusto. Se manca uno solo di questi, non è buono.
Convincere la gente facendo mangiare queste cose che poi la gente capisce quando mangia una cosa.
Allora, ritornare a livello locale a ricostruire questa memoria, questo patrimonio,
sì.
Questa è la via.
For example, Bordeaux, wonderful wine made with different grapes. Mm. What we're saying is take the same attitude maybe to a tomato or an aubergine. Maybe the price is less, but we still respect it and we still value it.
La sovranità alimentare di un popolo si realizza se ha le basi forti. E le basi forti sono nell'economia locale. Quindi rafforzare l'economia locale, prendere l'orgoglio anche della propria storia.
He's giving weapons.
Non è che io gli dico tanto che dobbiamo fare una battaglia. No, 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 tranquillo. Tutti tranquilli. Questa è una rivoluzione dolce.
It's a sweet revolution.
Cin cin.
Salute.
Sì, a noi.
Thank you. I'll see you later.
Carlo's philosophy makes perfect sense. in a region with such amazing producers. So I want to end the day by putting his principles into practice with a traditional menu.
I need some carrots for the marinade. Le cipolle per fare le cipolle ripiene, quale prendo? Quelle lì?
Allora, tu ne prendo quelle bianche che sono meno
forti. These root vegetables are crying out for something rich and earthy to go with them.
Buongiorno.
Here in Piedmont, they love their hunting, so the butcher always has the best game meat. I can't think of a better dish to reflect the traditional local cuisine than a stew of capriolo.
Ah, beautiful. Siamo in due. Perfetto.
The capriolo is a mountain deer, so the meat tastes similar to venison. I'm sure Andrew's gonna love it.
Ah, fantastico. Ringrazio tantissimo. Buona giornata.
Grazie. Buongiorno.
Allora, Cristina. Meanwhile, I get on with the much more serious business of choosing wine for dinner. Piedmont is home to some of Italy's very greatest wines, including my favorite red. Barolo.
Bell'alba.
Bello.
Ottimo, è un 2006, perciò di un'annata vecchia.
Perfetto.
Back at our farmhouse, I set to work on our Piemontese feast. There is no better way to make a rustic stew than on a real wood fire.
If you want a little bit more power, there we are. Take away one.
The more air you allow in,
the hotter it gets.
Brilliant. So no dials, no knobs. Is that like an Italian or Piemontese version of an aga?
That was actually the same stove that my grandmother used to have.
Really?
You know, Andrew, this is not the Italian food that is just so famous all over the world, you know? The kind of the Mediterranean diet, the olive oil. Here you got much more subtle flavors. And, you know, and the vegetables are much more root vegetables, so they sort of attach more to Central Europe than Southern Italy. Do you understand?
In a sense, maybe it's a kind of Italian food that has more in common with certain aspects of English cooking. The climate's closer.
Definitely. But a bit better than English cooking, that's for sure.
I'm saying nothing. This is pretty good food for some pilgrims who've just come down the hill.
Yes. OK, so, Andrew, that's our capriolo. Smell fantastic.
Wow, so that's been marinated, not in wine, but in vinegar.
In vinegar. It is not balsamic land. This is white wine vinegar land.
It's a great smell. It's very lean meat. What cut of the capriolo does this actually come from?
That would be a back leg, yeah?
It's been up and down the mountain.
That's what it is. It's really powerful anyway. I mean, when you see them running...
I've seen them, yeah. I've seen them when you're walking the mountains. They're the ones that you think, how on earth did that animal get up there?
That's absolutely...
So you think, how come it doesn't fall? It's almost like a cross between a deer and a cat.
It's time to pop the cork. Barolo's a full-bodied wine. It needs time to breathe.
I'm glad you approve.
I'm telling you, this is the perfect wine for what we're going to eat. This is a real farmhouse dinner. Have you got the plates?
I'll go and get them. That's okay. What I need, a farmhouse dinner.
I don't think that the farmer would actually serve it to you like that.
I was going
to
say, this is...
But, you know, I'm just doing a little bit of the Locatelli twist.
Yeah, you are.
Stuffed onions, celeriac mash, and a hearty portion of capriolo. I have been longing for this all day.
Andrew, after such a long wait, there we are.
Dig in.
Una cena in campagna, proprio. See, what is amazing is that, you know, it doesn't look like so attractive, like the color are much more northern European color of the food. It's white and gray, but how is it?
Really good.
Is it?
Really good, really rich. I was trying to think what it was, you know, why is it that the slow movement should have been born in northern Italy? And I was thinking, various things seem to come together in this part.
Right.
In the sense that it's always been a hotbed of
of intellectuals, thinkers. There's a very strong left-wing tradition in northern Italy. It's not like communist-type left-wing, but it's left-wing in the sense of the small against the big.
There is a saying in Piemont, contadino, contadino, scarpe grosse, va cervello fino. Which means...
I like it.
Farmer, farmer, big shoes, but fine brain.
The farmer who thinks. Which is Piedmontese.
The Piemontese farmer.
Piemontese.
One thing that makes Piedmont so special is its fertile, diverse landscape. But that's not the whole story. There's also its rich cultural history and strong industrial heritage. The best way to uncover this other Piedmont is to take our pilgrimage to its greatest city, Turin. Turin first flourished in the 16th century, when Emanuele Filiberto of the powerful Savoy monarchy made it his capital.
And in the 20th century, it became one of the most important industrial centers in Italy, thanks to Fiat and the Agnelli family.
I know the best place to get an overview of the city. Its most famous landmark, the Mole Antonelliana.
At 167 meters high is Turin's Eiffel Tower.
Wow! Look at that. What a view. I think a lot of people think of Turin because of its association with the automotive industry and Fiat and factories. They think of it as an industrial city, maybe forget that actually at the center, there's this wonderful, almost perfectly preserved Baroque city. It's actually quite French in feeling, isn't it?
Absolutely. The old things really works.
It seems to be almost organized as a series of theatrical displays. The buildings are almost like stage sets. Long avenues. Yeah.
Powerful city for a king. So not that many churches.
Not that many churches.
More outstanding building, but less churches than you usually found in Italy.
That's the Palazzo Reale, where the Savoy royal family lives. And at the back of their residence, in this otherwise crowded, completely built-up Baroque town, guess what? A huge park, as if to proclaim the fact that they rule the roost here. You know, we can afford just to have a garden.
But now it's a public park.
Now it's a public park.
The Savoys were ambitious and wanted a city to reflect their power and wealth. Almost everywhere you turn, you're greeted by imposing Baroque architecture. But for my money, the most impressive of all is the Palazzina di Stupinigi. It was designed by Filippo Juvara in 1729 as a hunting lodge for Duke Victor Amadeus II of Savoy.
It's modelled on Versailles, isn't it? It feels like Versailles.
And that's no coincidence. Victor Amadeus was married to Louis XIV's niece, and the Savoys were close to the French court.
That looks like Wedgwood, Andrew.
Wedgwood-style cabinet. It's sort of an index of everything that was fashionable in the 18th century.
Juvara was also a talented stage set designer, and this place has a real sense of theatre. Nowhere more so than the Grand Central Hall.
It looks like a cathedral.
Well,
it's like a church.
It is a kind of, well, it's a profane cathedral. It's a
profane cathedral.
It's a cathedral to the goddess of hunting. So you look up, you think, oh, is that the Virgin Mary? No. No, it's Diana. It's the triumph of Diana.
Oh, yes, il trionfo di Diana.
There are bows and arrows and dogs and dead animals and hunters and huntresses all over this room. They weren't great patrons of the arts. They weren't great readers. They weren't great patrons of music, but they loved their hunting.
Also love the idea that they have, like, statue underneath here. But then up there, they're not. They are painting those ones.
Trompe l'oeil. Also, it's all about plenty, isn't it? It's all about
that's
abundance.
That's what it looks like, yeah.
You know, whatever there is, we've got plenty of it. And if we haven't got it, we'll go and catch some.
And there's one place where their appetite for abundance and ownership is strikingly clear. It's located in a secret chamber, high up above the impressive cupola.
Isn't it fantastic?
The smell is absolutely brilliant, like tobacco and wood and
Delicious.
Who rules? We rule. It's a statement of power, isn't it?
It is indeed. Look at that. So geometrical as well. Must be an explanation why there is this like avenue that's going out like that. Is it just a show-off piece?
I think it's like, it's that idea of Louis XIV, the idea of the Sun King. The king is the sun. This palace is like the sun. It occupies the center of Piedmont and its rays symmetrically stretch to every corner of the land.
You definitely know who's in charge.
You certainly do.
By the 19th century, Piedmont under the Savoys was one of the most powerful Italian states. Supported by the monarchy and spearheaded by the Prime Minister, Count Camillo Cavour, the movement to unify Italy was born right here in Turin. Learned and clever, Cavour loved to discuss ideas, and in the vibrant cafe culture of 19th century Turin, he found the perfect place.
Fiorio was Cavour's favorite cafe, almost his office. It was so influential, it saved the king himself would ask every morning, "What are they saying in Fiorio?" The cafe was like an informal parliament where Cavour and his followers could speak freely.
E poi voi, signori?
I love this noise. There you are, Andrew. We are in the place. There is the picture of the man himself.
Grazie. Oh, grazie.
What is this?
This is called bicerino. And it's coffee, chocolate, and cream. So very, very dietetic drink. Mm. Oh, that is delicious.
Cavour plotted the campaign to unify Italy right here in Fiorio. It was Cavour and the king who were the power behind Giuseppe Garibaldi's military campaign.
Garibaldi was like the way we see in Che Guevara now, that sort of freedom fighter. They absolutely use his image in order to get that general popular approval, you know, because themselves they were pretty ascetic people. They didn't have much in common with the common men.
It's a popular uprising in a sense, in that the people greet and they welcome Garibaldi's conquering army
right.
as it moves south. But essentially, this is a movement that's sponsored by the king.
Mm.
Our man Cavour is a monarchist.
Yeah.
What are the ultimate consequences for this region, for Piedmont?
Well, Piedmont suddenly became the most important region of Italy. It collected taxes from whole Italy, and not Rome became the capital, but Turin became the capital of Italy. Or the first capital of Italy.
Let's drink some more chocolate.
To us.
Food for thought.
The city's cafe culture is still alive and well. I've never seen such an amazing range of pastries and chocolates. The Torinese really do have a sweet tooth. They especially love chocolate here, and were once the world's leading producer of the stuff. Ferrero Rocher and Nutella both hail from Piedmont.
Oh, the smell!
We can't miss a quick visit to one of the best chocolatiers in town, the laboratory of Guido Gobino. Here, they specialize in a very Turinese style of chocolate, il Gianduiotto. The story goes that the Gianduiotto was created during Napoleon's brief rule, when importing cocoa from South America was almost impossible. Always resourceful, the Torinese chocolate makers decide to concoct a paste from local hazelnuts and combine it with the cocoa to make their supply last longer. What might have been a disadvantage was turned into a winning formula. We are having a Gianduiotto tasting with Guido himself. His family have been chocolate makers for 50 years.
I remember eating these when I was little.
Buonissimo. The nuts and the chocolate go together very well. How would you recommend that one has this? With an espresso as well, in the same time? Or
espresso
just
maybe, or Moscato wine, because it's very flavored, fruity. Or Barolo Chinato, or red wine, spiced red wine.
You think that the Gianduiotto success is attached to the fact that it's based on the Nutella flavor? As you say, the grown-up Nutella.
Yeah, you still have the memory of your childhood.
The memory, it brings you back to that.
We thanks Nutella, because Nutella is the first flavor that people, young boys, taste normally in the world. Because you can find Nutella everywhere.
So you're still making these little objects, and you make them all here, but you sell them all over the world.
We export everywhere in small quantities, of course, because we are artisanal production. When I am abroad in Japan, for example, in Emirates, when people taste Gianduiotto, they love it, because it's very, very interesting tasting, and it is not traditional tasting like bitter chocolate or milk chocolate. This is very different, and this is the real chocolate or big cosa. It's made in Torino.
It is incredible that a place that has such a tradition, where chocolate is part of their, you know, life, and they know the capital of the chocolate. Oh, they are, but they don't kind of show it.
It is a philosophy of Torinese people to work hard and to make better as possible everything. Technology, for example, chocolate food. It's not important to show off that we are the best.
They are a bit understated, like the English.
Understatement, yes.
Understatement is a good word for us.
But maybe we should just very quietly wish Guido good luck.
Grazie, Guido.
Ciao, grazie. Grazie a voi.
Grazie.
Dedication and hard work really are in the blood of the Torinese. Turin, like its neighbour Milan, fosters the tradition of a strong work ethic. It's what the city's success is built on. And there's one company more than any other responsible for that success. Fiat. Founded in 1899 by Giovanni Agnelli, it flourished in the post-war years when money from the Marshall Plan kick-started Italy's economic boom. Fiat's enormous Lingotto factory became a nucleus for the city's workers. In the 50s and 60s, hundreds of thousands of immigrants from southern Italy settled in the surrounding area to work for Fiat.
This is the Lingotto.
This is the famous Lingotto factory.
This is the Lingotto factory.
So this reminds me of the Palazzo Stupinigi. You know, the Savoia monarchy's gone, but now we've got the Fiat family. Yeah. They're the kings of the new economic miracle.
Oh, and the Agnelli were the family at the head of this corporation of industrialists that really had experience after the traveling to America to really pick up this American dream and giving it to the Italians.
So was Fiat, in a sense, you know, the General Motors of its day in Italy? It was, you know, this is the Model T, that, you know, that everyone is going to drive this car, everyone can afford to drive this car.
And, you know, to make something reasonably cheap enough for them to drive around was part of this, and Fiat was right at the heart of that.
And my standout favorite of those affordable cars is the 500. Cheap and cheerful, it's become an icon. Thanks to the passion and dedication of specialist mechanics, these vintage cars are still on the road today. I've been told in the workshop of Michele and Mauro Miola is packed full of 500s in restoration. It's a must for a fan like me.
Ciao, Mauro. Piacere. Io sono Giorgio.
Sono Andrea. E questo è il tuo padre?
Sì, è il mio
papà, sì. Michele?
Buongiorno, Michele.
Che significa per te questa macchina? È solo una macchina o è più di una macchina?
È più di una macchina. Abbiamo fatto di tutto con questa 500.
If you're from a Catholic family where, you know, like the mother and the father, like, keep an eye on the children, maybe this is the first place that you're actually private.
I'm sure that a lot of the kids, and they are in their 50s now, they were conceived in this car.
Tu ricordi la prima volta che ha dato un bacio a una donna nella questa macchina?
Sulla 500D.
On the 500D,
he remembers which car! È possibile di vedere una macchina, come si dice?
Finita.
Finita.
restaurata.
È perfetto.
Yeah? Ne sì, hai sì, una finita?
Tutto. Sì.
Yeah? Possiamo vederla?
Sì, certo.
Andiamo. Andrew, look at this. No way. This is so beautiful. Oh.
That is something, isn't it?
That's like a showpiece. È bellissima.
It's a beautiful piece of design, isn't it?
Yes, definitely.
I can't leave without getting behind the wheel of one of the Miola's precious 500s.
Gently.
Yeah, gently. I'm just trying to think of it.
Convince her, not...
Convince her.
Yeah. Have you... the brakes would be nice as well.
You feel like you're driving a piece of history.
It's more like you're destroying a piece of history. A little bit more kind. So you see, it's like the car changed society completely at every level because, I don't know, like a vet, a doctor, a nurse, you are in a remote village, suddenly you call and they can come to you now. So it is a part of society. That's, I think, why the people love it so much.
I can imagine perhaps someone who's come from Sicily to come to the north. What a sensation when they go back to their village in their brand new Cinquecento.
Show off that they've become a modern man in modern society.
I love the sound when you go, you know, when you put a bit of gas on. Andiamo!
The economic boom years were also the glory years of a great Italian art movement. Arte Povera emerged here in Piedmont in the 60s as a kind of protest against the rapid industrialization of Italy. The artists of the movement took the ordinary materials of everyday life and used them to make art. The Museum of Contemporary Art in Rivoli, on the outskirts of Turin, has an unrivaled collection of Arte Povera. A world away from the opulence of the Baroque, it's down to earth, almost homemade. I wonder what Giorgio will make of it.
So this is probably the most famous work of Arte Povera, Venus of the Rags, it's called, by Michelangelo Pistoletto. And I think, you know, being Italian, of course, he's thinking about the past, thinking about statues of Venus. But I think what he's saying to us is, how do you represent a person? How do you represent a human being? For me, the rags could be a portrait of a person, perhaps through all the clothes they ever wore.
All his life.
Yeah.
That's right.
If you imagine like a huge pile of laundry, that's everything you ever wore. Your body was in there, in there, in there, in there, in there, in there, and this is sort of kind of an accumulation. So either you're this permanent ideal figure, or actually maybe not. Maybe you're more imperfect, you're more ragged. Maybe your life is a process rather than a state. So I want to know what you think of this. It's kind of like a portrait of Italy by another member of the Arte Povera generation. He's called Luciano Fabbro.
This is a tombino. This is a pothole cover. I like it. Two Italy, one upside down, and then Sicily and Sardinia stuck on it. Funny here, in years where they made Italy, so it was almost like, you know, the first concept of Italy was born here. And so now to have an artist that does this and turn it upside down and stuff the bit together, I guess it's got to do with that.
So again, it's the ordinary material of working everyday Italian life.
The rust as well, I like.
Yeah.
The rust is beautiful, isn't it? Look at that.
I mean, how do you make a portrait of Italy? I think it's quite a good one.
There's a piece here by my favourite Arte Povera artist, Giuseppe Pannone. Unsurprisingly for a Piedmontese artist, his work focuses on man's relationship with nature. This room is made entirely of laurel leaves.
It's beautifully quiet.
Wow, it smells fantastic. What's that? Is that a pair of lungs?
Yeah. It's a bronze cast of laurel wreaths. It's like, you know, slow food. I think this is, for me, this is slow art.
Slow art.
You just let it work on you. It's a funny thing. We're indoors and we're in an art gallery, but I feel like if I close my eyes, I'm almost back to the beginning of where we started our trip. See that little sort of chapel on the edge of the valley? Because it's a room for contemplation. That's maybe right. This is like a modern artist's version of a pilgrimage chapel.
And the god is nature.
Absolutely.
I also like the idea that you coming in here and you breathing in these things, and so it stays in your lungs and you're taking a bit away with you. I think it's lovely.
So you become part of it.
You are part of it.
I think that's part of its meaning.
Yeah?
I've seen Pannoni's work in museums all over the world, but seeing it here confirms just how deep-rooted his connection is to his homeland.
And that connection is so totally Piemontese. Their commitment to the land has produced one of the most fertile territories in Europe. And the rice fields of Vercelli, in the plains north of Turin, are the most prized. The locals have worked hard for centuries to cultivate the best condition to produce rice here. And now, there are more than 100 varieties grown in these paddy fields. The most popular is Carnaroli. For us chefs, is the king of risotto rice.
Now, I want to show you this rice because it's so beautiful. Come and have a look. Look at this.
So this is straight out of the field.
This is straight out of the field.
This is what I eat in my risotto.
Yes, these are the pearl of the Baraja. The rice from this rice field.
If you came here in the first half of the year, this would be like almost like a landscape from China. It would be like a paddy field.
This would be more like Chinese paddy field because it would be small paddy field. And you can see also they are in different levels in order to work with the water. So you have different levels of it. And there's very small tenement all the time.
And is this a natural microclimate for rice then? The cold air and that makes it just right?
Just perfect. And also the perfect, beautiful, pure water that comes from the mountain.
I would imagine that cold air is bad for a crop, but for rice it's not bad, is it?
It strengthens it. This area has received the DOP, the Denominazione di Origine Protetta, so protected or denomination of origins, because this has been proved that it is, you cannot produce anything equal than there anywhere else. This rice is being crossbred and made to what it is through years of experience of the people.
The exceptional rice grown here has made Vercelli the rice trading capital of Europe. The town's rice market, the Borsa Vercelli, is the Wall Street of the rice world, and the price set here each week becomes standard across all of Europe. It's a fascinating game of nerve. The floor is packed with millers and brokers haggling over prices.
So here you have the broker, and the miller will check out the quality of the rice. Look, now he's changing the board, and he's going to look here on the whiteboard to see.
Oh, I see. So he's looking for slightly discolored grains.
That's right. He says there is a lot of them who's got a little broken one, and there's a lot of them, they are slightly bit grey.
So he's saying to him, there's quite a lot of grey ones in here, I can't give you the top dollar because it's not best quality. And he's saying, oh, well, no, come on, it's not that bad.
That's right.
I love these two boards. It's almost like a game of chess.
This must have been used for hundreds and hundreds of years, this system.
The broker Giacomo and Miller Giuseppe are busy haggling, but they seem to be struggling to come to a deal.
What price do you want from Giuseppe?
Yes, I want 350 euros for tons.
Today, our margin is around 330.
Giacomo looks very interested at this point. So yes, okay, so 330.
It's very important for me.
For him, it's important because he's obviously has the rice there, dry, ready to go. He wants to get rid of it, otherwise he cannot pick up any other.
He have not enough spice.
So he knows that, so he's going to be a little bit of a tackle there.
So can,
Can you help in some way, Giorgio? Maybe you could be a diplomat.
I think that they've been going on like that for the last 1,000 years. I don't think that they need our help. I'm telling you.
These hidden sides of Piedmont, little tales, chance meetings, are showing me a whole new side to a region I've always loved. Back in the 80s, when I first visited, it was the art that opened my eyes to Piedmont's special character. And on that trip, one place in particular caught my imagination. The UNESCO-protected heritage site called the Sacro Monte of Varallo, an hour's drive from Vercelli. This extraordinary place of pilgrimage is made up of 45 little chapels, each representing a scene from the life of Christ. First constructed in the late 1400s, it's evolved and expanded over the centuries. It might not be high art, but for me, it's as fundamental as the great masterpieces of the Renaissance in creating the culture of this land. There's one chapel in particular I want to show Giorgio. It's stayed with me since my first visit here. A gory, violent interpretation of the massacre of the innocents.
I think you really understand what the effect these sculptures were meant to have on people when you look at this one. The appeal is not to the head, you know, the appeal is to the heart. And this horrible scene of children being massacred, it's hard to look at.
I think it makes you feel really sad and really worried. I'm sure you're gonna, if you're here with your kids, you just grasp him and walk away.
I think it takes you to the scene almost too well.
The attention to detail is stunning, down to the sword, and really you can see it's entering the body. And look at the sufferance of the mother trying to save the baby. You can almost hear them screaming. Yeah.
Well, I think it's there to put
the fear
of God into you. I mean, it's definitely this place. I think this whole sacred mountain is a kind of machine made to ingrain faith in the people who came here, to really make them believe.
In a very spectacular way.
Yes, if you don't pray to God, if you don't behave like a good, devout Christian, you know, maybe these things will happen to you. Each chapel is like one scene in an unfolding story.
Yes, like a modern film almost. You're going through, you're going to know that it's going to be the final thing is the resurrection. But you still have to go through all the thought and the pain and everything else.
The chapel I want to take a look at is the one representing the Last Supper.
Quite a spread.
It is quite a spread. And what is amazing, Andrew, look, they don't have just bread and wine, like in the Bible, but they got all the produce that they are from this area. Look, the freshwater fish, like trouts and things like that. They've got two different types of cheese in there, and you can actually recognize them very well. With the one on the right, that's a Castelmagno. And that one, because it's got a red skin, is Castel Rosso, which are really typical cheeses from this area. So they were eating as well something that the people actually knew.
Yeah. So you can actually identify the cheeses as being from here.
And the two different cheeses from here.
Well, I think that was the idea. I mean, because in the instruction manuals for the artists of the time, it always says, make the people feel at home. Mm-hmm. You know, it shouldn't feel like it's 2,000 years ago in the Holy Land. It should feel as if it's taking place in Piedmont, and that's what they've done.
I would like to cook this dinner.
After seeing the various stages of Christ's life, we get to the chapel where the story reaches its climax, the crucifixion.
At this moment, the maximum moment of empathy, you know, where you're supposed to feel Christ's suffering, you're allowed to occupy the same space as his mother, you're allowed to occupy the same space as the disciples looking up.
You are really touched by it, and you feel like you've seen every scene, and he has a little bit of that sort of feeling of a theme park, but for the soul.
I mean, in a sense, the modern theme park is a debased version of this. You know, Disneyland. You make the pilgrimage to go there, you know the stories, you've seen the films, and now you meet the characters, you shake hands, except all the spiritual content
has been removed. And whereas you end your visit to Disneyland, perhaps with a trip to the shop, here, you end your visit by going down into the basement of the church and paying your respects to the holy image of the Madonna.
The basement chapel is like a people's museum of faith and devotion, a place where they offer remembrance or give thanks.
What I love about it is it's like a history of the kind of accidents that could have befallen you in Piedmont over the centuries. Here we've got somebody who got attacked by a highwayman.
That's right.
Here you've got a terrible rail crash that occurred at the beginning of the 20th century, and there...
To electricity
accident.
To go more recent, you remember them a few months ago, the Costa Concordia? There must be somebody who was on the Costa Concordia and he felt then the Madonna blessed
him. It's not necessarily that you just came to pray you would be saved. If something happened to you and you had a close shave...
Very close
then
shave.
Then you attributed it to...
To the fact that your faith allowed us...
Saved you. Well, I suppose it just shows that for many people, you know, the church is still the first port of call.
This is from 1807. And what happened is this, then this Alfonso Cabara, captain of the Italian regiment, had received two shot, and the Maria Santissima saved him.
But isn't that amazing that you've got the Napoleonic Wars, someone surviving that, cheek by jowl with someone surviving a bicycle accident in the 50s.
Grazia ricevuta.
There must be a thousand human stories in here.
Absolutely.
Our journey through Piedmont has been so rich and full of variety. I feel we have seen most of the special things this wonderful region has to offer.
Well, all except one. We've still not visited any of the great wine producers this region is so famous for.
That's because I saved it for last. We're going to spend the evening at Contratto, one of the great historic wine houses of the Lange. I know the guy who owns the place.
I'm so excited about it because, you know, it's been bought by a friend of mine called Giorgio Rivetti, which is that
here
guy
is,
there. Giorgio, come stai?
Benissimo, tu?
Fantastico.
Ah, super. Oh, nice to see you.
Brilliant. Hey, nice
Andrew.
Thanks for having us. Oh,
it's great. Pleasure to be here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for coming here.
It's a new place,
yeah,
new house.
Something new for me. Something exciting. Yeah, you know me. I love to produce Barbaresco and Barolo, but my passion is about bubbles, too.
Yeah. Giorgio is one of the best red wine producers in Piedmont, so it's exciting that he's turning his hand to sparkling wine. And we can miss a tour of the cellar, the secret of the success of Contratto Champagne Method wine.
Yeah.
Wow!
Look at that.
Yeah. This is a cathedral.
The temperature is
UNESCO protected this wine cellar were dug out of the old limestone hills of Canelli in the 19th century. Ingenious local winemakers discovered the constant temperature of 13 degrees inside created the perfect condition to ferment the wine naturally. Giorgio's always got his eye on business, but he hasn't lost sight of the small but important rituals of winemaking. 30,000 bottles a day are turned manually here to loosen the sediment inside.
Hello, Mauro.
Piacere.
Posso provare?
Faccia.
Don't mess around.
Una la mano la prima, sì. L'altra la quarta.
Ah, la ok.
Poi si spostano.
No.
Maybe,
no.
No. Maybe you can move.
Andrew, like that.
Okay, go on,
like that.
No.
No? I missed the one in the middle.
No, sì, una no. Una sì, una no. I think you are better in the kitchen.
Please. After turning the bottles, the sediment inside must be released so the wine can be laid down to mature. This is the bit I've been waiting for.
Oh, no, aspetta.
Wow. Yeah.
No way.
Because this wine is in life. It has a life inside.
Look, the half bubbles. Of the bottle shoot off.
Yeah.
That was incredible.
Giorgio, man! I'm scared to open it now. After what I saw downstairs.
No, don't worry.
It's gonna be a shower.
It smells quite sweet.
He's got the, like that crust, bread crust.
Yeah. Yeah. It's typical for sparkling wine.
Alla salute.
Salute.
A te,
salute.
Salute.
Cheers. Cheers.
Alla tua ventura. I can imagine this with some fish.
Oh, yeah. Oysters, too.
Oyster. Fantastic.
Piedmont is a corner of paradise, really. You can, we have a lot of beautiful grapes and this beautiful land. 99% of the top wine producers in Piedmont, they are farmers. And this is something special. Right. Something special. They know everything about the vineyard. They are respecting the environment because they do everything organic. Okay? They do beautiful job in the vineyard. They are producing small quantity of fruit, small quantity of wine. But the wine, they are unbelievable.
And they're probably doing the same thing that their father did, and maybe their father did.
Looking after the land.
Yeah.
So although you're a large producer, you want to keep the philosophy
of course.
Small producer
of course.
For your own wine.
No, really. Farmer philosophy. Okay, this is so important for me. I don't want to change this, of course.
Here's hoping cheers. You never do change it.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers. To us cheers. And to Piemonte.
Piemonte. Yeah.
If Giorgio and his kind stick around, there really won't be any space for big multinational here. It reminds me of that old Piemontese saying, farmer, farmer, big shoes, but sharp brains.
And the heart of Piedmont for me will always be the countryside, the original source of everything that is so magical about this hidden gem of Italy. Our pilgrimage has come full circle.
See, Andrew, when I think about Piemontese, I always really think about people with incredible amount of resilience, you know. They really are, they fight things over and they turn things over. And they made Italy, they rule it. You know, they're the first capital of Italy. Here they have people like Carlo Petrini coming in and says, listen, you got a great amount of value on this land.
I keep coming back to these leaves. Sandrino's dog snuffling among the leaves. Even the artwork is made of the leaves.
That's right!
You know, that beautiful piece by Pannoni. Right. This real, I think this sense of connection to the land is so strong here. It seems to me, it feels to me, as if the cultura popolana is now on the way up. In fact, that's what people come here for now. What do you think your favorite experience has been? What do you remember?
For me, the most magic moment is when Sandrino's dogs got the truffle out of the ground. It's such a moment, isn't it, to find this pearl that is kind of hidden away. It's fantastic, and it just puts me, you know, back. You know, I'm sitting in London trying to sell these things to people, and suddenly, you know, here I am just picking it out of the ground. It's magic for me, that.
I've been coming back for that experience of the soil, you know, for the humble pilgrimage church, for the terracotta statues at Varallo, for the experience of eating the funghi porcini, the venison that you cooked.
The truffle.
Of course. Andiamo.
Duma va.
So, where do you think we should go next?
I think the best place to go now is to go for lunch, man.
Still to come, the best bits of the series devoted to HQI is here on BBC HD next.